Well, Jennifer and I would have gladly remade any David Cronenberg movie. Dead Ringers was something we were pretty dead set on getting. And then one December, we got an email that said, would you like to remake Rabid? And so the answer was, of course, yes.
He's just the most influential filmmaker in the world. Not just the films that he makes, but the career choices that he makes. He continues to do his own thing. He's such an artist. He's never delivering anyone's message but his own. And he sticks to his convictions. So as a mentor and as an artist, it's just such an honor to translate his material for a new generation. And that's really what I feel that our new film is, a translation or a modernization of a classic tale.
And we had been in the film industry for a while at this point, about 13 years, and we were getting extremely disillusioned with the movies we had and the opportunities we got. I mean, after American Mary, they kept us away from body horror for years.
Yeah.
We were game show hosts. We didn't get to direct a movie for years. And then Rabid comes, and it's David who had such an effect on the directors we became. And it was almost like going back to film school and obsessing about somebody and falling back in love with what filmmaking was. And through that experience, I think it turned out into a really wicked, cool movie. I mean, you're not supposed to be my therapist. I don't know if I'm supposed to say all that, but, you know, a lot of heart went in there.
Well, Laura, I always thought was a sensational actress, but unfortunately, it was much like Catherine Isabel. I didn't see her getting the opportunities or the roles that she deserves. She's an incredibly beautiful girl, and unfortunately, people get caught up in just how beautiful she is. So all she does is get cast as beautiful, and the character development is somebody's in love with you. And it's just absolutely foolish. David said about his original Rabid that love is useless. I mean, it's nice, but it's not really going to help you. And we really took that theme and we ran with it.
And the cool thing about Laura is she wasn't afraid to go there in every aspect. Like, I mean, this, if you've seen the original, and I don't want to spoil ours, but it ends with Marilyn Chambers' Rose being thrown in a garbage can, and that's uplifting compared to what goes through Rose's new adventure in our remake with Laura. So you really needed to have an actress who was really willing to play ball, and she was even putting on producer hats. Like, the reason why Greg Brick is in there in that amazing scene is she called him up and made it happen. It was like, it was really wonderful.
It was so important to us to find actors that also, like us, had a real love and an appreciation for Cronenberg. If they didn't know who Cronenberg was and they weren't willing to learn, there's no place for them. But thankfully, like, CM Punk was a huge fan of David Cronenberg. Ben Hollingsworth, who played Brad, amazing fan. And Ted Atherton, Mackenzie Gray, Hanneke Talbot. And,
of course, Tristan Risk.
Tristan Risk, you don't even have to say. Tristan Risk is our muse. So, of course, anything I know, she knows to the 100th degree. And Laura, I gave her Cronenberg on Cronenberg, and like, this is everything you need to know about the man from his own words.
And she was so cool about it because David originally wanted Sissy Spacek, and he ended with Marilyn Chambers. So I felt she was like kind of a blend of those two actresses. And there's a few moments where we tried to recreate things that had happened in the original movie. And Laura would watch the movie, and then I would be looking at my monitor, and I'd be like, oh my God, Laura, you look just like Marilyn. And I was like, oh my God, I feel like she's working through you. Have you ever been in a body horror experience yourself?
I mean, every time I look in the mirror, but apart from that,
this year, my cat that I loved more than anything needed a partial mandibulectomy because he was misdiagnosed with a cancerous tumor on his jaw. So to have to accept an aesthetic that isn't gorgeousness and accept something that you love, having to have part of its face removed, and then teaching him how to drink again, teaching him how to live, and if you watch the movie, now you're hearing me talk about battling cancer, I think you understand why Dr. Burroughs does the things he does there. It was extremely therapeutic, and it was extremely important to me to show to people. So if you see Rabid, it isn't as horrific if something like that happens in your real life, because you have like a fantastical version. You're like, oh, wow, okay, that's kind of like what happened in Rabid. If it's never happened before, it could be really shocking. So I like that it artistically exists there as like a safety net for people with body horror.
I think horror films in general are incredibly cathartic, not just for the creators, but the audience as well. And I love to make things that people think are disgusting and ugly and show the humanity there and make it beautiful. With American Mary, I hated that people vilified the body mod community while they said anyone that gets breast augmentation is, yeah, cool, that's great for that. But when you're fitting into someone else's ideal of what is good for you is not good for you. And, you know, that's also another message in Rabid. When Rose makes her own choices, things go well. And when she lets somebody else convince her, things go bad. And I think that some people forget that there are very negative parts in life. There's times that you don't have censors just coming in and hiding the bad parts from you. So our films really make it more acceptable, and it's kind of like you can go up to the most terrible experience of your life, but on your living room table, or living room table, if you sit on the table, if you're on your couch, wherever, it's just a safe way. Yeah. It's a place for survivors to just come and enjoy. And when people say they don't like horror movies, they haven't watched everything. It's like saying you don't like porn. What are you searching?
Yeah, but also our movies aren't for everybody, and neither are Cronenberg's, but you know, the UK always seem to get it before everybody else, so we're grateful to be here.
Yeah, smart people like our movies.
Ha!
We do.